वेलकम। सब्जेक्ट में मैथमेटिक्स 1, सब्जेक्ट कोड है 151। टुडे वी विल स्टडी टेलर्स एंड मैकलॉरिन्स थ्योरम। सो फर्स्ट वी लुक एट द स्टेटमेंट ऑफ टेलर्स थ्योरम। स्टेटमेंट ऑफ टेलर्स थ्योरम says that if we have a function fx and if this function fx is differentiable and have derivatives f dash x, f double dash x, and so on, f n x, up to the order n. So if we have a function, and if this function f x is differentiable, and have derivatives up to order n in the interval a plus h, in the interval a plus h, for every value of x, then there exists at least one number theta between 0 and 1, such that we can write that f a plus h will be equal to f a plus h upon factorial 1 f dash a plus h square upon factorial 2 f double dash a plus and so on up to nth term, h to the power n minus 1 upon factorial n minus 1 fn a plus theta f, fn 0, fn minus 1 0 plus. So these are the first n terms of this series, fn minus 1 a. Then there will be a remainder term of this form, x to the power n factorial n fn a plus theta h. So this is the statement of the Taylor's theorem, and we can look at it as an application of the concept of derivatives. So it is an application of derivatives. So by calculating derivatives, we can write this series form, this series representation for a given function fx of this form. So if we know the values of the function and its derivatives at a, then we can calculate the value of f a plus h by Taylor's theorem. Another form of this Taylor's theorem can be obtained, which we will be using, by substituting h equal to minus a. So if we substitute h equal to x minus a in this series representation, finite series representation, you can see that we have finite terms in this series, and after n terms we have a special term having value of the derivative at f a plus theta h instead of the value of the derivative at a. So you can see that in all the previous terms, first n terms, we are calculating the value of the derivative at a, whereas in last term we are calculating the value of the derivative at a plus theta h. So I write the popular form of the Taylor's theorem by substituting h equal to x minus a in the above result. So that result says, if I will substitute h equal to x minus a, then I will have fx on the left hand side and fa, and in place of h I will write x minus a, f dash a will remain f dash a, then x minus a square upon factorial 2 f double dash a plus and so on, plus x minus a to the power n minus 1 upon factorial n minus 1 f n minus 1 a plus x minus a to the power n upon factorial n f n a plus theta into x minus a. So this is another form of Taylor's theorem, and it is popular, and it gives us the idea that using Taylor's theorem we can expand fx in powers of x minus a. So if we want to write a function fx in powers of x minus 1, x minus 2, in powers of x plus 1, then accordingly we can select the value of a and write the expansion of the given function in powers of x minus 1, x minus 2, or x plus 1. Next point is that this Taylor's theorem was motivated from a mean value theorem, Lagrange's mean value theorem, which you may have studied in 12th class. The Lagrange's mean value theorem is a very interesting theorem which says, so I remove these sentences from here. You must have note down these sentences. Now Lagrange's mean value theorem, so I will explain this theorem in brief. Lagrange's mean value theorem, MVT. So this theorem says that if we have a curve and if A and B are the endpoints of this arc of the curve, then the chord, if I consider a chord joining A and B, then according to Lagrange's mean value theorem, it is the geometrical meaning of Lagrange's mean value theorem, then according to Lagrange's mean value theorem, we will have at least one point P. We will have at least one point P on the curve where the tangent will be parallel to this chord AB. So this is the geometrical interpretation of Lagrange's mean value theorem, that if we have a curve and if we consider the small portion of this curve in the form of an arc AB, A and B are endpoints, and if we draw a chord joining A and B, then according to Lagrange's mean value theorem, and it is obvious that we will have at least one point on the curve where we will be, where the tangent will be parallel to the chord AB. Now, if I assume that x coordinates of A and B are small a and small b, and this curve denotes a function fx, then I can write Lagrange mean value theorem in algebraic form. So that will be in this form, fb minus fa upon b minus a will be equal to f' c, where c will belong to the interval a and b. So how I have written this algebraic result from the geometrical interpretation of Lagrange mean value theorem? What I have done is I have calculated the slope of this chord AB. The slope of this chord AB will be fb minus fa upon b minus a, because the x coordinate of a is small a, so y coordinate will be fa, and x coordinate of this point capital B is small b, so y coordinate will be fb. So that is why the slope of chord AB will be fb minus fa upon b minus a. And what is fsc? fsc means this c is any point between a and b. So c is the x coordinate of the point p. So if I draw a tangent at this point p, then the slope of that tangent will be equal to f dash c. Now, because we are saying that both the chord and the tangent will be parallel, so their slopes will be equal. So this result follows from the geometrical meaning of the Lagrange mean value theorem. If you remember, you may have studied this theorem and you may have verified it for several functions. Next, if I write b minus a equal to h, if I write b minus a equal to h, then I can write this theorem in this form, that f a plus h, so b will become a plus h, equal to f a plus h, this b minus a will become h and will get multiplied with f dash c. And in place of c, I can write a plus theta h, where theta lies between 0 and 1. Where theta lies between 0 and 1. So, with this notation, our endpoints will be a and a plus h, or endpoints will be a and a plus h. So a plus theta h will lie in between a and a plus h, because we are considering the value of theta between 0 and 1. So what I want to say is that we can write Lagrange mean value theorem in this form. And this was the point of motivation for Taylor's to have this higher mean value theorem. So Taylor's theorem is actually a higher mean value theorem. So you can see that Taylor have extended the Lagrange mean value theorem in this form, having terms up to the powers of n minus 1 or n, and having remainder in terms of nth derivative instead of first derivative, having remainder in terms of nth derivative. So now I have used this word remainder. So what is remainder? Remainder is this last term of this finite series representation of the Taylor's theorem. So this term is known as Lagrange's form of remainder. This term is known as Lagrange's form of remainder. There are other forms of remainders by Cauchy and Rosse, but we will study Lagrange's form of remainder for our purpose. So you can understand, you can observe that to calculate the Lagrange's form of remainder, we need to know the nth derivative of a given function. And we will see that the calculation of nth derivative is not possible except for a few simple functions like e to the power x and sin x, cos x, 1 plus h to the power m, log 1 plus h. So for these elementary functions, we can try to calculate the nth derivative and we can have the exact form of the nth derivative. But for in general, for any function, it is not practical to have a form for the nth derivative of any given function. So that's why we will study remainder terms for the elementary functions e to the power x, sin x, cos x, and for the other functions we generally write formal Taylor series expansion, formal Taylor's infinite series expansion. So we write an infinite series representation for the given function. How do we write that infinite series representation, infinite Taylor series representation for a given function? So for that, I am trying to explain the idea behind obtaining infinite series from this finite form of the Taylor's theorem. So according to this result, we can see that f a plus h is actually equal to Sn plus Rn. So I am denoting the first n terms by Sn and the last term by Rn, because I am saying that the last term is remainder. Remainder term. So if I can calculate that limit n tends to infinity Rn is equal to 0, if somehow if I calculate the remainder term and if I can write that limit n tends to infinity Rn is equal to 0, then you can observe that in this case f a plus h, the left hand side of the Taylor series, will be equal to limit n tends to infinity Sn, because limit n tends to infinity Rn is tending towards 0, so f a plus h will be equal to this. So in that case, when limit n tends to infinity of the remainder term is 0, in that case the left hand side f a plus h in the Taylor's theorem will be equal to an infinite series. So for many of the functions, we can calculate first 4 or 5 terms to write the infinite series expansion. And in case if we can find the nth derivative, the form of the nth derivative, then in that case we will be able to write the general term of the infinite series, and in that case we will also be able to decide what is the exact value of the remainder and how this remainder term tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. So we will study remainder terms with elementary functions, as I have explained earlier, for e to the power x, sin x and cos x. And for remaining functions, we will study the formal infinite expansion by assuming that the nth derivatives of the given function exist and the remainder term tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. So this was the statement of the Taylor's theorem. Now MacLaurin's theorem is nothing but a particular case of the Taylor's theorem. So I can briefly write the method to write MacLaurin's theorem from Taylor's theorem. So MacLaurin's theorem can be obtained from Taylor's theorem by substituting A equal to 0. So if we substitute A equal to 0 in this last form, in this last form of the Taylor's theorem, then we get MacLaurin's theorem. fx equal to f0 plus x minus a, because a is 0, so we will have only x f dash 0 plus x square upon factorial 2 f double dash 0 and so on up to x to the power n minus 1 upon factorial n minus 1 and nth derivative at, because a is 0, so nth derivative will be at theta x only. So I have written the finite series representation form for the MacLaurin's theorem, and this term, okay, so up to n minus 1 we will have the terms for the main series, but after this we will have the remainder term of this form fn theta x. So you can compare this MacLaurin's theorem with this form of the Taylor series theorem, and you can observe that we have simply obtained this theorem by substituting simply a equal to 0 in the Taylor's theorem. Further, you can note down the difference that MacLaurin's theorem expands a given function in powers of x only, whereas the Taylor series theorem expands the given function in powers of x minus a, where a can be any real number. Further, initially for this Taylor series theorem I used this interval of validity, that this theorem will be valid near a in this interval, and when I will write h equal to x minus a, then our interval will be a x. So this expansion is valid near a. Further, if I use this idea, then the interval of validity for MacLaurin's theorem will be 0x, because I have substituted a equal to 0. So the interval of validity for MacLaurin's theorem is this, and this is the Lagrange's form of remainder for MacLaurin's theorem. So I can write it here. You can note down that this is the Lagrange's form of remainder for MacLaurin series. Next, we will calculate the remainder term for the elementary functions, and we will also see that how Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, and how we obtain the infinite series representation for a given function. So we will study this for, first we will study this for a function e to the power x. So if we have a function fx equal to e to the power x, and if there are instructions in the question that for this function, find Maclaurin's series with Lagrange's form of remainder, with Lagrange's form of remainder and so that the remainder tends to 0 as the summation index, as the summation index n tends to infinity, So what we have to do is that for a given function f is equal to e to the power x, we have to find Maclaurin's series with Lagrange's form of remainder, and we have to show that this remainder term tends to 0 as the summation index n tends to infinity, and write the formal infinite series, for e to the power x in powers of x. So when we will write a series for a given function in powers of x, then we will be calculating the formal infinite series, formal Maclaurin's infinite series for the given function. So we try to solve this problem. So we have Maclaurin's theorem, x to the power n minus 1 factorial n minus 1 f n minus 1 0, and the remainder term x to the power n upon factorial n f n theta x. Now to do this, we will take the given function and we will start differentiating it. So when we will start differentiating it, we will observe that every derivative will be equal to e to the power x, because e to the power x remains unchanged while differentiating. So that's why we can write that fn x will also be equal to e to the power x. Now to write Maclaurin's theorem, we will need the values at 0. We will need the values at a 0 point. So we calculate the values of the function and its derivatives at 0. So we get f0 equal to 1, f0 equal to 1, f0 equal to 1, and so on up to nth derivative. Fn minus 1, 0 will also be equal to 1. But for remainder term, we will require the value of nth derivative at theta x. So we will calculate fn theta x for remainder term. So fn theta x will be equal to e to the power theta x. So to write, because fn x is equal to e to the power x, so fn theta x will be equal to e to the power theta x. Now with this data, we can write the Maclaurin's series with Lagrange's form of remainder. So we write that, so e to the power x will be equal to 1 plus x square upon factorial 2. I have not written factorial 1 here because factorial 1 is always 1. but you can, fortunately you can write here x upon factorial 1 and so on, plus x to the power n minus 1 upon factorial n minus 1 plus then the remainder term. So remainder term will be equal to x to the power n upon factorial n and e to the power theta x. So this is the application of Maclaurin's theorem to the function e to the power x, and this is the finite series representation of the function e to the power x in the by the Maclaurin's theorem with the Lagrange's form of remainder. Next, what we have to show? We have to show that the remainder tends to 0 as the summation index n tends to infinity. So we have this remainder Rn, and Rn is equal to x to the power n upon factorial n e to the power theta x. Now we check. So if you check the limit n tends to infinity, then limit n tends to infinity of x to the power n upon factorial n e to the power theta x, then we will observe that limit n tends to infinity of x to the power n upon factorial n is always 0, but e to the power theta x will remain finite. It will remain finite. It will not be equal to 0, whatever be the value of x. So we conclude that this limit tends to 0, because e to the power theta x will remain finite, and the x to the power n upon factorial n tends to infinity limit will be 0. So this remainder comes tends to 0. Therefore, we can write the formal infinite series for this function. So we have this infinite series for e to the power x, which we generally write in this form up to first few terms, or sometimes we write general term x to the power n upon factorial n plus and so on up to infinity. So in this way we have calculated the infinite series representation of e to the power x. You must have used this series, infinite series representation of e to the power x, to calculate limits of the functions involving e to the power x, but you may have not seen the proof of this infinite series expansion of e to the power x. So here we have seen the proof of the infinite series representation of e to the power x. Next, we will try to calculate similar similar Maclaurin's infinite series for other function. So when we will take sin x, then our calculation will look like this. So because this time we have a function sin x, so we will start differentiating it. Fx is sin x and the address x is cos x, then the second derivative will be minus sin x and so on. If you will observe carefully, then you will find that address x is actually sin x plus pi by 2. So by the knowledge of trigonometry, you know that sin pi by 2 plus x is equal to cos x. Next, you will observe that address x is actually equal to sin x plus 2 into pi by 2, means sin x plus pi, and you know that sin pi plus x is equal to minus sin x. Similarly, you can check this pattern successively, then you will find that the nth derivative of sin x will be this, sin x plus n pi by 2. you can go through the chapter on successive differentiation in any book of engineering mathematics, and you will find the proof for the nth derivative of sin x, cos x and other functions. So this is the procedure through which we can have the nth derivative of sin x. Next step will be to find the value of derivatives at 0, because for the Mantois series we require the values of the functions and its derivatives at 0, whereas in Taylor series we will need these values at other points other than 0. So we will be calculating values at a or any number other than 0 when we will be calculating Taylor series. So here we are studying Mantois series. So we calculate the values of the derivative. F0 will be 0, F0 will be 1, it will be 0, then we will have minus 1. So this Fn minus 1, 0 will be minus 1 to the power n minus 1 by 2. Or so you can observe that when your derivative is odd, first derivative, third derivative, then you will get non-zero value. And when your derivative is even, then your derivative will be 0. So I observe this pattern, then I find that f2n minus 1, 0 will be equal to minus 1 to the power n minus 1. So if you want to verify, you can calculate the third derivative also. The third derivative will be minus cos x. So f double s 0 will be equal to minus 1. So when n will be equal to 1, so you will have plus 1. When n will be equal to 3, when it is 3, then n is equal to, because we are comparing this with this, so when n is equal to 1, n is equal to 1, then we will have 1 here. So for f dash, n is equal to 1. Now when n is equal to 1, we will get plus 1. Now go to this f third derivative at 0. So when n is equal to, so how will we get 3? When n is equal to 2. So when n is equal to 2, we will get 4 minus 1, 3. So for f triple dash, we have n equal to 2. So when we write n equal to 2, 2 minus 1 will be 1. So we will have minus 1 here. So that's why I have written that f2n minus 1, 0 will be equal to minus 1 to the power n minus 1, and f2n 0 will be equal to 0. So this gives us the first n non-zero terms. So 1 here, n equal to 2, and here n equal to n. So now according to Mantois theorem, I can write that sin x will be equal to, sin x will be equal to, first term will be 0, first term will be 0, term serving x to the power 1 will be there, so I write it x, and f as 0 is equal to 1, so I am writing x. Now f double s 0, so there will be no term having x square, because f double s 0 is 0. Now f triple dash is minus 1, so I will have a term containing x to the power 3 upon factor 3, and in that case the derivative will be minus 1. So that's why I have minus 1 here. Similarly, if you will further calculate, you will find this pattern. You will find this pattern that we get all powers of x with alternative plus minus sign. And finally, we will have x to the power n minus 1 upon factorial n minus 1 minus 1 to the power n minus 1 for this value of the derivative. We have 2n minus 1, 0 equal to minus 1 to the power n minus 1. Now we need to write the remainder term. So, remainder term, I calculated it separately for Rn. Now, remainder term will be equal to sine x plus 2n. So, in place of n, I have to write 2n. So, I will have n pi. And in place of x, I will be writing theta x. So, I write here theta x. Now, sin theta x plus n pi, this will be equal to minus 1 to the power n sin theta x, according to our knowledge of trigonometry. So, how I have written this remainder term? Remainder term is equal to x to the power n upon factorial n, fn theta x for Maclaurin series. So, I have substituted the value of fn x with x due to theta x. So, I got sin theta x plus n pi by 2. Now, for this, after this term, the value, so I will have value x equal to 2n minus 1 and factorial 2n minus 1. So, after this, I will have x to the power 2n upon factorial 2n. And the remainder term will be with n equal to 2n. So, I will have sin theta x plus n pi, and which will be equal to minus 1 to the power n sin theta x. Correct? So, what I have done is, I have written first n non-zero terms, and then I have calculated the remainder. So, the remainder for sin x will be this. X to the power 2n upon factorial 2n minus 1 to the power n sin theta x. Now, here we can check that as limit n tends to infinity, Rn tends to 0. Why? Because as n tends to infinity, x to the power 2n upon factorial 2n will tends to 0. In the similar way as x to the power n upon factorial n tends to 0, but sin theta x will remain finite. We know that the value of sin theta always lies between minus 1 and plus 1 and is always finite. So, it will be non-zero. Therefore, the remainder term will be equal to 0. So, if the remainder term is equal to 0, then we can write a formal infinite series expansion for sin x without remainder term. So, we will have an infinite series representation for this series of sin x. So, this is the Maclaurin's theorem, remainder and formal infinite series for sin x. Now, we do this calculation for cos x. Now, when we do this calculation for cos x, then we will find little bit variation. So, when we will differentiate original function in cos x, when we differentiate, we will get minus sin x, and next we will have minus cos x, and after this we will have plus sin x, and finally we can observe the pattern and we can write that fn x will be equal to cos x plus n pi by 2. So the nth derivative will be equal to cos x plus n pi by 2. we can observe this pattern by noting that minus 9x is cos x plus pi by 2, and this minus cos x is equal to cos x plus 2 into pi by 2, means cos x plus pi is equal to minus cos x. So we can observe the pattern and we can write the nth derivative, and after this we can calculate the values of the function and derivatives at x equal to 0 for Maclaurin series representation. So f0 will be equal to 1, f dash 0 will be equal to 0, f double dash 0 will be equal to minus 1, f triple dash 0 will be 0. So here we observe that even derivatives are non-zero and all derivatives are 0. So even derivatives are non-zero, so we will have our nth term here at 2n. So at 2n 0 will be equal to, f2n 0 can be calculated. If we write n equal to 2n, then we will have cos x plus n pi, and if we write x equal to 0, then we will have cos n pi. So even derivative will be minus 1 to the power n. Cos n pi is equal to minus 1 to the power n. Next, after 2n, we will have 2n plus 1 term. Now we will calculate this 2n plus 1 term at theta x for remainder purpose, because f 2n plus 1 at x equal to 0 will be 0, because you can see that all derivatives are 0 for this function cos x. So f 2n plus 1, so for remainder term we calculate f 2n plus 1 at theta x. Now when we calculate f 2n plus 1 theta x, then we get cos theta x. So I am writing this explicitly because this calculation, there is some misprint, or this calculation has been done incorrectly in many of the books. So I am writing the correct version. So we will have remainder cos theta x plus, and in place of n I will have 2n plus 1. So we will actually have this cos theta x plus 2n plus 1 by 2 pi. So 2n plus 1 will always be all that we can observe. Now this cos theta x plus 2n plus 1 pi by 2, by applying our ideas of trigonometry, we observe that it will be equal to minus 1 to the power n sine theta x. Whereas in many of the books you will find that they are writing this term equal to minus 1 to the power n cos theta x. So according to them, the remainder term for sine x will be in terms of sine theta x, and the remainder term for cos theta x will be in terms of cos theta x. Whereas the truth is that the remainder term of sine x is also in terms of sine theta x, and the remainder term for cos x is also in terms of sine theta x. Now we can write the formula, we can write the finite Maclaurin series representation for cos x. So the first term f0 is 1, so I write 1, then the odd derivative term will be 0, so we will add even derivative term x square upon factorial 2, and the derivative of even derivative f double dash 0 will be minus 1, so that is why I have minus 1 here. If you will further calculate, you will observe this pattern that we are getting even powers of x with alternative plus minus sign. And finally, for corresponding to x to the power 2n, x to the power 2n upon factorial 2n, we will have minus 1 to the power upon factorial 2n plus 1 into this minus 1 to the power n sine theta x. So this is the remainder term, and when n tends to infinity, this remainder term tends to 0. It can be shown similarly, because as n tends to infinity, these types of term x to the power 2n plus 1 upon 2n plus 1 will tend to 0, and sine theta x will remain finite. So the remainder term will tend to 0. So we can also have an infinite series representation for cos x of this form without remainder term. So you can listen my word carefully. What I am saying is that we can write infinite series representation for cos x without remainder term, because we have observed that the remainder term Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay? So up to these elementary functions, we can easily calculate nth derivative, and we can easily analyze the limiting process of Rn as n tends to infinity. But for other functions, for other complicated functions like log sin x, e to the power sin x, we may not have the pattern for nth derivative. That is why in almost all the books you will find problems on Maclaurin series and Taylor series without remainder. So that is the reason. So up to this point, I have given you the idea of remainder term, and I have shown you that how remainder term tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. And next, we will look at some examples of verification of the Maclaurin's theorem for some particular functions. So next I will discuss questions on verification of Maclaurin's theorem. Verification of Maclaurin's theorem for some functions. Here I want to emphasize that we have questions on, we will study questions on the verification of Maclaurin's theorem. Whereas in the book you may find that they have mentioned Taylor's theorem, which is incorrect, because the intervals of the given problems, well, the intervals of the given problems involves these types of interval 0 x. So in these types of interval, as we have seen in this statement, only Maclaurin's theorem will be applicable. So I take question for verification of the Maclaurin's theorem. So one question is solved in the book itself. I consider the next one, in which we have a function, we have interval 0, 1, and we have a function fx equal to 1 minus x to the power 5 by 2, and we have to verify Maclaurin's theorem. We have to verify Maclaurin's theorem. We have to verify Maclaurin's theorem up to 3 terms. In the book, an example of verification up to 2 terms is given. Here we can see verification of Maclaurin's theorem for this function up to 3 terms. So first we write Maclaurin's theorem up to 3 terms. So according to Maclaurin's theorem, any function fx can be, the first 3 term will be f0 plus x f dash 0 and x square by factorial 2 f double dash 0, and then we will have the remainder term. then we will have the remainder term x cube upon factorial 3 f triple dash theta x. So this is the remainder. Now by verifying Maclaurin's theorem, we mean that we will actually find the value of theta, and we will show that the value of theta lies between 0 and 1. And if we can find the value of theta, and if the value of theta lies between 0 and 1, if we can show that, then that means that we have verified Maclaurin's theorem up to these terms. So here in this case up to 3 terms. So to solve this problem, we have function, we have our interval 0, 1. So we calculate the function, the derivatives of the function. So the function is this. Now first derivative will be equal to 5 by 2, 1 minus x to the power 5 by 2 minus 1. So 3 by 2 into minus 1 according to chain rule. Next, we will calculate the second derivative. The second derivative will be equal to minus 5 by 2, 3 by 2, and 1 minus x to the power 3 by 2 minus 1. So we will have half. Now again minus 1 will come. So here we will have plus. Next, we calculate the third derivative, and we observe that the third derivative will be equal to 5 by 2, 3 by 2 into 1 by 2 into 1 minus x to the power half minus 1. So minus half, and we will have a minus sign here. So in this way we have calculated up to third derivative. Now we calculate the values at 0, because for Maclaurin's theorem we need values of the functions and derivatives at 0. So at x equal to 0, f 0 is 1. At x equal to 0, f dash 0 is minus 5 by 2, and at x equal to 0, f double dash second derivative will be equal to 5 by 2 into 3 by 2, and it will be equal to 1. So we will have 15 upon 4. Next, we will need the value of third derivative at theta x. So we write f triple s theta x equal to f triple s theta x equal to minus 15 upon 8 into, because x is, we are writing x as theta x, so we will have 1 minus theta x to the power minus half. Now we have these values, and to verify, what we do is that we put x equal to 1 on the left hand side. To verify, we find the value of theta. To find the value of theta, we put x equal to 1 in this result. Then, so for that we will need the value of function at 1. Now the value of function at 1 is 0, because we have 1 minus x to the power 5 by 2. So f1 is 0. So if I write only these values of derivative at, these values of the functions and derivatives at 0, then I will have this result, that 1 minus x to the power 5 by 2 according to Maclaurin's theorem, because my fx is 1 minus x to the power 5 by 2, will be equal to f0 means 1 plus x into f dash 0 means minus 5 by 2 x plus x square upon factorial 2 means x square upon 2 into 15 upon 4 means plus 15 upon 8 x square. And after this I will have a remainder term x cube by 6, factorial 3 is equal to 6, and f triple s theta x. So if I will need, I will write the value of f triple s theta x, because I have calculated the value of f triple s theta x. Next, to find the value of theta, we put x equal to 1. So when we put x equal to 1, the last value of the given interval. So when we put x equal to 1, we get 0 equal to 1 minus 5 by 2 plus 15 by 8 plus, because x is equal to 1, so we will have here 1 by 6, and the value of third derivative is available 15 by 8, but we will write x equal to 1, so we will have 1 minus theta to the power minus half. Instead of 1 minus theta x, we will have 1 minus theta to the power minus half. Now from this result we can find the value of theta, and when you will try calculating the value of theta, you will find that the value of theta is equal to 11 upon 36, which is equal to 0.302 approximately. So in this way we can verify Maconis theorem for a given function. In the next class we will look at some more examples of series expansion, in which we will include examples for Taylor's theorem also. So for Taylor's infinite series we will see some more example in the next lecture.